covered the induction motor and three-phase transformer mainly. Now the induction motor portion I will cover. Now you have studied DC machine. So DC machine is a rotating machine and induction motor is also a rotating machine. But that this is a three-phase motor. Now, basically, before going to the induction motor, so I will just have an introduction for three-phase voltage generation and rotating magnetic field generation, which is essential for induction motor operation. Now, you have studied DC machine and transformer. Now, the basic, all basic electrical machines that is based on the basic principle of Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, which states that whenever a flux linking any coil changes, there is an EMF induced in the coil. Now, in case of transformer, this change in flux can be of two types. In case of transformer, the coils are stationary. But the coils are stationary, but as the supply is alternating in nature, so the flux created by the primary winding is alternating in nature. So as the flux is changing with time, it induces EMF in the secondary winding. Now, in case of DC machine, what we had, we have a the field was DC, so the flux was DC, magnitude was constant, and it was stationary in space. But the armature winding was, in case of motor, I am talking. In case of generator, I am talking about some. Armature winding was rotated by a prime mover, so there was a relative motion between the stationary flux and the rotating armature. So due to the motion, there was that flux linking the armature coil was changing, so there was EMF induced in the armature. So this armature this EMF was induced due to rotation of the coil, so it is called dynamically induced EMF or rotational EMF. Now, and in case of transformer, it is statically induced, it is the transformer EMF. Now, when we go for the AC voltage generation, now I have got basic figures of rotating machine. Now, there can be these four are the basic, that is, we have a stator and the rotor. So one possibility is that we have this A, and A dashed is armature coil. So we have the armature on the stator, and this is the field coil on the rotor. So we can have armature on the stator and field on the rotor, and the field is circular in shape. So this is a cylindrical rotor machine. And in the circular rotor, we have slots where the field winding is housed. So this is one possibility. Secondly, it is in this figure also, we have the armature on the stator and field on the rotor, but the field is no longer circular in nature, not cylindrical. This type of construction is called salient pole construction. Projected poles, and there will be a concentric winding on the structure which will create this north and south pole. So here we have the armature on the stator, field on the rotor, but the field is salient pole in nature. So someone is betting, I think. So next, the third possibility is that here also the rotor is cylindrical. But we have interchanged the position of armature and the field coil. That is, now field is on the stator and armature is on the rotor. And the fourth possibility is, again, the armature on the rotor and field on the stator, but this was cylindrical rotor construction. This is again a salient pole construction. If we have a salient pole construction of field, the structure will look like this. So this is the four combination we can have for rotating machine. Now this structure, I think it will look familiar to you, because this is the combination what we use for the DC machine, for both DC motor and generator. That is, we have projected fields on the stator where we have concentric field winding, and on the rotor we have slots. In the slots we have the distributed armature winding. Now so in all the cases you can see that whatever be the structure of the machine, when there is a relative motion between the armature coil and the field, in this case when field is on the rotor, field is DC but it is rotated by the prime mover, so as the armature coil is stationary, so there will be a relative motion between the armature and the field. Here also the same thing, the field is on the rotor that is rotated by the prime mover, so there will be a relative motion between the armature and the field. In this case, field is on the stator but the armature coil itself is moving, so there will be a relative motion. Here also, field is on the stator, the armature coil is rotated, so there will be a relative motion. So in all that four cases there will be EMF induced in the armature winding. Now which construction to follow? Now in case of DC machine, this construction I think looks familiar to you, because this is the construction of a DC machine. In this in what happened, you can in all the cases the EMF which is induced is alternating in nature, that is changing with time. Now in case of DC machine also, actually the EMF which is induced in the conductors are alternating in nature. What we do, we connect these conductors to the commutator and brush assembly. Then the commutators are insulated from one another by insulation, and the brushes are fixed in space. So this commutator and brush assembly acts as a mechanical rectifier. So it rectifies the AC voltage induced in the armature to DC. So we get a DC output. So in case of DC machine, this is the only possible construction what we can follow, because what we want is a DC output. So if we do not follow this construction, then we cannot utilize the advantage of commutator and brush assembly, and so in that case we have to rectify the EMF by some other means. So the simplicity of the combination is lost. So for DC machine we always have this combination, but when we go for AC for a simple DC machine, instead of connecting the armature conductor to the slip ring, to the commutator, if we connect them to two slip rings and collect the voltage through brushes, then what we will get is an alternating voltage. So basically the alternating voltage generation and voltage generation in DC machine, the principle is the same, but in case of alternator we have all these four possibility. That is, any four of these can be used for alternator. Now there are certain reasons why in alternators we always follow these two type of construction, either this or this. Now when we you study the synchronous machine, we will discuss it in details. Just briefly let us say that the advantage is that the when we here you can see that here and here we have put the armature on the rotor. Now when we put some coil on the rotor that is rotating, and so the coil is subjected to mechanical vibration and centrifugal stress. Now this mechanical stress puts some limitation on the voltage rating, because the insulations we use to when they are subjected to mechanical vibration, their voltage withstand capacity reduces. So the same insulation which when put on the stator, which can resist high voltage cannot resist that when the winding is put on the rotor. So a static winding is easier to insulate. That is one of the reason. Secondly, a static winding is easier to cool also than the rotating winding. Then if we put the armature on the rotor, then the so if the armature is a high power circuit, high voltage, high current circuit. Now obviously we have seen that as the voltage level depends on the insulation. So if we put on the armature on the stator, then we can go for a higher voltage rating. Similarly for the current rating will decide the volume of copper required. So if the current is high, the copper amount will be higher, required will be higher. So copper is a heavy metal, heavier than iron. So putting a high current winding on the rotor will increase its weight. So that gives a mechanical limitation from point of view of the from mechanical point of view, because that moment of inertia becomes large. See, and lastly is that the slip ring is also made up of copper. So as the current rating of armature winding is higher, the slip ring required will be heavier. So that also adds to the weight of the rotor. So if we go place the, instead of placing the armature on the rotor, if we place on the stator, so we will be able to go for higher current rating. So if we place the armature on the stator, so we will it is possible to attain the high rating both from voltage and current point of view. So for synchronous machines, which are very large machines in the range of MVAs, so they are all, we have the armature on the stator and the field on the rotor. Now this one for cylindrical rotor, this construction is used for high speed synchronous machines used for with thermal power plants, that is with steam turbines. And these salient pole machines used for hydro power plants with this, where the speed is low, because the number of pole with depends on the speed. So for high speed machine, number of poles will be low, and for low speed machine, number of poles will be high. When the number of pole is high, it is difficult to wound it on the cylindrical rotor. It is easier to have a salient pole structure. So this structure, these two structures are followed with AC generator. This is for cylindrical rotor synchronous machine. This is for salient pole synchronous machine, because synchronous machine is the main source of AC generator. Now here I have shown single phase winding on the armature. Now instead of one winding, if we put three windings, this is a single phase alternator with one winding on the stator. Instead of that, if we put three windings 120 degree apart, then we will have a three phase generator. So normally now increasing the number of phases, we can also increasing the number of phases. So we can have any number of phases, but normally we have three phase generation, because that three phase generation distribution transmission is most economic. So in general, AC supply comes in three phases. So basic construction is that we have three phase winding. Now I have shown concentric winding, but actually the winding will be distributed in the armature slots. So we have three phase distributed winding on the stator, and on the rotor we have the field winding. This is for the cylindrical rotor. Similarly, we could have for the salient pole machine. So what are the magnitude of the voltages induced? Now flux linkage is say psi. So flux linkage is number of turns into flux. So n into, say, what is the flux linkage? Now, if you see, this is for any of these figures. Say, for this figure, this is the stator. This will be the armature axis. Something I've just copy pasted, so it is written wrong. So this is the armature axis. This is the axis of the armature coil. This is the axis of the field coil. Better look at this. This is the stator axis. This is the field axis. Now, when the field axis and the armature axis are coincident, then the flux linking this coil is maximum. And when the field axis has armature axis and the armature axis with the stator axis here at 90 degree, then the flux linkage is zero. So it, we can consider it to be a cosine curve. So n into, we can write n into phi m cos phi theta r. Theta is, r is the angle between the field axis and the armature axis. And so it is equal to n phi m cos omega r t, where omega r t is the rotational speed. So induced EMF E is d minus d psi of dt. This minus sign, you know, it comes from Lenz's law. That is, the EMF which is induced will oppose the cause. So the minus sign comes. So if differentiate, we have two components. Now this voltage is the dynamically induced voltage or rotational voltage, because this is proportional to the speed. And this is proportional to the rate of change of flux. So this is the transformer voltage. Now in this case, we have DC supply. So phi magnitude is constant. So this second component is zero. So this is the EMF which is induced. So maximum value will be n phi m into omega. Now omega and omega r is same, because we have a two pole machine. So in general, I have written omega. So this is omega is twice phi f n into phi m. This is the maximum value. So RMS will be 1 by root 2 of that. Now, what is the relation between the rotational speed and the supply frequency? Now, look at these two figures. This is a two-pole machine and this is a four-pole machine. The basic construction used for the DC machine. Now, here you can see that for a two-pole machine, the physical distance between the north and south pole is 180 degree. So as the armature coil rotates to 180 degree, the conductors changes position from north pole to south pole. Now if we go for a four pole machine, you can see that the physical angle between north and south pole here is 90 degree. However, if we look for the electrical wave, the physical distance between this point and the this point is 90 degree. But for the electrical wave travel, its distance will be 180 degree. So we define two angles, the mechanical angle and the electrical angle. So for two-pole machine, mechanical angle, electrical angle is equal to mechanical angle. For four-pole machine, electrical angle is 4 by 2 mechanical angle. That is, here as the armature winding moves through 180 degree, the electrical wave moves through 180 degree. Here as the armature winding moves through 90 degree, electrical wave moves through 180 degree. So in general, theta electrical is equal to P by 2 theta mechanical. So P is the number of pole. So if we differentiate, d theta electrical dt is equal to p by 2 d theta mechanical dt. Now d theta mechanical dt is the omega r, rotational speed. And d theta electrical dt is omega, the frequency of the alteration. So this is equal to, f is equal to p by 2 n. So you can see that the frequency depends on the speed and the number of poles. So if the speed of the prime mover is high, then the number of poles required is low. if the speed is low, the number of poles requirement will be high. So for coal fire plants, that is for use which use steam turbines, the speed is high, so number of pole requirement is low. Either 2 or 4 pole machines are used, so there we have cylindrical rotor construction. But for hydel power stations where we have water turbine, the speed is very low, so number of poles required, because we want the frequency to be constant, that 50 hertz, so we will require P to be very high. There we have to go for the salient pole construction. So in general, we can write the now this speed, you can see it is proportional to the supply frequency. For a constant frequency and number of pole, it is constant. So this is called the synchronous speed. So AF is equal to P by 2 NS. Normally, synchronous speed is indicated by NS. You can see that these dimensions are same because NS, this is RPS, revolution per second, frequency hertz means that is also RPS. The magnitude dimension is same. So NS is equal to 2F by P. If you write in RPM, then it is represented by capital F. So this is 120F by P. So from here for 50 hertz system, for 2 pole, we have NS is equal to 3000 RPM. For 4 pole, it is 1500 RPM. For 6 pole, it is 1000 RPM, and so on. So this one I have explained that instead of one armature winding, if we have 3 armature windings placed 120 degree apart, we will have 3-phase voltages induced. So what is the nature of the voltage? The voltage curves will look like this. These are the 3 curves which are 120 degree shifted. So we have a 3-phase supply. Now next is the winding distribution. Now the whatever I have shown, the armature winding, I have shown armature winding to be concentrated. But obviously it is not possible to concentrate all the turns of a large armature winding in one slot, and because then we are not utilizing the total machine periphery, and this slot will be huge, and that is not possible, that is impractical. So basically that turns are distributed, there are number of slots on the armature surface or the stator surface, and the windings are distributed over it. Whatever I have shown is just a representation, because number of slots will be very high, not just for explanation purpose. I have shown only 12 slots. Say we have 12 slots, and in each slot we have this single conductor, 12 conductors. Then what happens if this is our rotor position? So we have seen earlier that if we consider the flux to be a cosine wave, your EMF is a sine wave. So EMF is maximum in this coil, okay, whose axis and the field axis are perpendicular. So for this particular position, EMF is maximum for conductor 1 and conductor 7, but they are just 180 degree apart, because if this is north, this is south. So this is E1 and E7. The EMF in these two conductors can be represented by these two phases. Now, what happens to all the other conductors? These conductors also link some flux, not the maximum, but some value of the flux, which is cosine proportional to cosine of the angle between this this angle, this slot angle of this slot sustained with this axis. So that if the maximum EMF which is induced here is say E, so for the and this angle is say gamma, then this for this conductor 2 there will be E cos gamma. Similarly for conductor 3 it will be E cos of twice gamma. For the conductor 4, this is coincident, so this is cos of thrice gamma, but here it will be 0 because that is equal to 90 degree. And similarly, we have for all other conductors. Now, So the EMF which are induced in these conductors depends on the position of the field winding with respect to the particular conductor. Now, what happens? This field winding is rotating. Now, after some time, this north will come here. When this north pole is here, then maximum will be induced in this conductor and this conductor. For this, the EMF will be E into cos gamma, for this E into twice cos gamma, and so on. So basically, at any particular point of time, instantaneous EMF, which is induced in the conductor, is equal to the cosine component of the maximum EMF along the field axis. So this EMF induced in the conductor can be represented by these phases. That is, this is the maximum EMF which is induced in that particular conductor. And this is when we are drawing the phasor, not the maximum, we are presenting the RMS values. So these are the EMFs, but for any particular instant, the EMF what is induced in the conductor will be projection of this EMF along the field axis. So for this particular figure, this is the field axis. So for 1, it is E1. For 7, it is E7. For 2, it is E2 cos of gamma. For 3, it is E3 cos of gamma, and so on. When this knot comes here, so for 2, it will be E2. For 8, it will be E8. For 3, it will be E3 cos of gamma, and so on. So the instantaneous value of the EMF will be projection of this EMF along the field axis. Now, as we have considered equal number of conductors in each slot, so this magnitude of these EMFs are equal. That is E1 equal to E2 equal to E3, E3, and so on. So all EMFs are equal. So from this figure, you can see that these slots are evenly distributed, have equal number of conductor in each slots, and EMF are induced in the maximum value are equal. So the summation at any instant, you can see it is zero. So these EMFs can be drawn in polygonal form like this. If we as the summation is zero, so if we draw them like this, so they will make a closed polygon. Now, these things we will discuss again in details during your synchronous machine class. So, but unless we derive this, we cannot go for the induction machine. So, this is the things what is explained here. So look at into the, now let us make a coil. Now these are 12 conductors. Now say we want to make a three-phase winding. Now what we do, say we make a coil with conductor 1, 2, 7, and 8. Okay. So what is the position? This is the flux wave, say. So this E1 was at the maximum position. Then we have E2. Similarly, E7 has maximum negative. Then we have E8. So we connect like this, E1 to E7, then E2 and E8. This will be the output. Now, what will be the output voltage? You can see that E1 and E7 in this figure, they are 180 degree opposing. Magnitude is same, 180 degree opposing. But when we trace this circuit, internal circuit, so they are just additive. That is E1 plus E7. So the output from this coil is E1 plus E7. Similarly, these two, E2 and E8, are additive. And they are 180 degree opposing. So there's just simply arithmetic addition. So E2 plus E8. So the output of this coil is E1 plus E7. Output of this coil is E2 plus E8. But this the EMF output of this and output of this are not in phase. There is a phase difference of gamma. So this is the output of this coil and this is the output of this coil. So what is the resultant we obtain at between point A and B? So this will obviously be the vector summation of these two phases. So if we draw this, that this is E1 plus E7, then this one from tip of this, so E2 plus E8. So this is the resultant. AC is the resultant. You can see that the arithmetic sum, that E1 plus E7 plus E2 plus E8, is obviously larger than this. This is because this is the third arm of the triangle. So this plus this is greater than this. So what is the magnitude? We can derive from here. Now, as the EMFs are makes a closed polygon, so all these points will lie on a circle. So from there, we can see that the angle they sustained at the center will be also gamma. So this angle is gamma. So from B to here, this is gamma, this is also gamma. So if you consider this triangle, that is AOB, then AB will be twice AE. So what is AE? This is OA, sine of angle, the AO, sine of angle gamma by 2. So AE is OA sine of angle gamma by 2. So EMF per coil is equal to twice AE equal to twice OA sine of angle gamma by 2. And what is the output? Output is this one. So for output, the angle is twice gamma. So this output will be OA sine of angle twice gamma by 2. So in general, these two comes because I have taken two coils in series. So instead of that, if we have few number of slots per pole per phase in series, then the sum will be it will be twice OA. This, for this case, it was twice OA sine of twice gamma by 2. But if there are few slots per pole per phase, then it will be twice OA sine of Q gamma by 2. But what is the arithmetic sum? Arithmetic sum will be, if there are Q coils in series, so it will Q into twice OA sine of gamma by 2. So the ratio of the, we define the distribution factor for the fundamental is the phasor sum of coil EMFs divided by the arithmetic sum of the coil EMFs. So this is twice OA sine of Q gamma by 2 divided by Q into twice OA sine of gamma by 2. So it is sine Q gamma by 2 by Q into sine of gamma by 2. So this is called the distribution factor. This is for distribution factor for the fundamental, because we have derived with respect to the fundamental flux wave. Now this Q gamma, Q is called the number of slots per pole per phase. So into, and gamma is the phase angle, the slot angle. So this Q into gamma is the phase spread. So this is, and for this expression, this gamma is very small. So when gamma is very small and expressed in radian, then sine gamma by 2 is approximately gamma by 2. So we will have Q gamma by 2 in the denominator. So this is, can be written as approximately sine sigma by 2 by sigma by 2. So this is for the fundamental. Now, we will have some harmonics in the wave, flux wave. We cannot make it exactly sinusoidal. So let's consider a third harmonic. If this is the fundamental and this is the third harmonic, you can see that as the fundamental moves through 180 degree, the third harmonic moves through 3 into 180 degrees. So in general, as the fundamental moves through 180 degree, nth harmonic will move through n into 180 degrees. So any angle theta for the fundamental is equal to 3 theta for the third harmonic and n theta in general for the nth harmonic. So your distribution factor for the nth harmonic will be sine u n gamma by 2 divided by q sine n gamma by 2. Again, considering gamma to be small, we can write sine n sigma by 2 by divided by n sigma by 2. So the what is the effect of distribution in the winding? So one, we can see that the output of the distributed winding will be always less than the arithmetic sum of the EMF which is induced in the conductor. So voltage reduces slightly, but there are certain advantages. This, the voltages which are induced are multiplied by this distribution factor. Now if you calculate, you will see that distribution factor for the fundamental is all very large, very high, almost equal to 1. But as the magnitude of the harmonic increases, the distribution factor go on decreasing. So the EMF which are induced by the higher harmonics is multiplied by a smaller distribution factor. So whatever be the content of harmonic in the flux wave, the content, the percentage content of the harmonic in the EMF wave is reduced by distributing the winding. So the reduction advantage is the reduction of harmonic in generated wave makes the voltage approximately sinusoidal. Secondly, better utilization of armature iron and copper. As I have told that it is not possible to consider all the copper in a particular slot, then the machine size will be huge. We are not utilizing the total iron periphery. So it is utilizing the armature and the copper better. And third is adding rigidity and mechanical strength to the winding. As we distribute the winding, winding will have better mechanical strength. So we will have distributed winding in all AC machine. We will have distributed winding. Next is that here we have considered a full pitch coil. That is the this coil side and this coil side are 180 degree apart. Plus. Please, 1 minute, sir. Hello, sir. না আমি আসিনি, আমি একটু ক্লাস নিচ্ছি, একটু পরে আপনাকে ফোন করব, ঠিক আছে? I'm sorry. So for this coil side 1 and 7, they are 120 degree apart, because here it is under the maximum flux positive and this is under maximum plus negative. Now instead of that, instead of this conductor 1 and 7, if we connect conductor 1 and 6, say, and 2 and 7, then what we have is the short pitch coil. That is, this conductor, this was the full pitch coil. Instead of that, I have considered the conductor 1 and 6 and 2 and 7. So when we are connecting 1 and 7, the output of this particular coil was E1 plus E7. And this was E2 plus E8 because they were 180 degree opposing. But the output of this coil is E1 plus E6, but this is a phasor sum. So the output of this coil will be, because E1 and this is E6, so internally they are adding. So this will be, resultant will be E1 plus E6. So obviously output is less than the arithmetic sum of E1 plus E6. Similarly for E2 and E7. Now if we look into this angle is gamma. Actually here I have considered one slot pitch, so this is gamma. Here this angle is gamma, so this angle is 180 degree minus gamma. So this plus this plus this is 180. So this angle is gamma by 2, this angle is gamma by 2. Now I have used here epsilon because this is equal to gamma, because I have short by short pitches the coil by one slot pitch. Not necessarily we should short pitch by one slot pitch, might be more than that. So in general, if the coil is short pitched by an angle epsilon, so this angle is epsilon by 2, this angle is epsilon by 2. So from here we can see that this will be this OA cos of epsilon by 2 into 2. So if you take the ratio of the EMF, which is a resultant voltage of short pitch coil divided by resultant voltage of full pitch coil, it is cos of epsilon by 2. So pitch factor for the fundamental is cos of epsilon by 2, where epsilon is the short pitching angle. And the nth harmonic, for the nth harmonic, this pitch factor will be cos of n epsilon by 2. Now, obviously, epsilon here is equal to gamma, but it can be a multiple of gamma. We cannot short pitch by half slot pitch, but some multiple of the slot pitch. So it is related to short pitch, but not always equal. Now, there are certain advantages of short pitching. First of all, it reduces the copper overhang. What is the overhang? Now, when we, I do not have a figure here, when we connect the coil, the active conductor is the portion which lies in the iron. Now at the both the end, we have to make the coil. So there are certain portion which is required to copper to connect the winding. That portion on both sides is called the winding overhang. So as for short pitch coil, the two slots are nearer, so it will reduce copper overhang and it reduces harmonics. Again, the pitch factor for higher harmonics will be smaller, so it is multiplied by higher voltages induced for higher harmonics is multiplied by smaller factors, so it reduces the harmonics further. In fact, by considering a particular value of epsilon, some harmonic can be make equal to zero, because our winding factor is then distribution factor into the pitch factor. Now in case of three-phase machine, third or triplet frequency harmonics, that is 3, 9, etc., are taken care of by the star delta connection, and as it is a symmetrical system, so symmetrical wave, so we do not have the even harmonics. So the next harmonics which are important are fifth and seventh, because as the harmonic order increases, the magnitude decreases. So fifth and seventh are the most considered. By choosing a chording angle, these harmonics can be reduced. For example, if we choose epsilon is equal to 30 degree, then KP1 is 0.966, KP3 is 0.707, KP5 is 0.259. KP7 is minus 0.529 and KP9 is minus 0.707. By putting the values, you can calculate. You can see that with this fifth and seventh harmonic is multiplied by these small factors. So the fifth and seventh harmonic content will reduce, making the EMF more sinusoidal. So we normally have short pitch, distributed short pitch winding on the stator. Next is that what is the MMF distribution of this winding? Because when coil is coil is carrying some current, it will create some MMF. Now consider this first figure. We have one coil on the armature. So when the armature EMF is induced in the armature, and if we connect a load, it will carry some current. Now when the current is flowing through the armature, it will create a field. That is the armature reaction field, what we call. Now that field axis will be along this axis. So depending on the star cross I have shown, this will be the field distribution will be like this. This is the armature reaction field. Now what is the nature of the armature reaction field? We assume certain things. We assume that stator and rotor iron are infinitely permeable. So most of the MMF is required to establish the flux through the air gap. And for induction motor, for motor near AC machine, machines, the tear gap is normally very small. So flux distribution across the air gap can be considered radial. So these were the two conductors. These two conductors, this one and this one. So if we split and distribute like this, then the flux distribution can be shown like this. So flux distribution, you can see between these, this is maximum, then this is negative. So approximately this is rectangular in shape. Now this rectangular flux distribution, if we analyze it by Fourier transform, then we will have a fundamental and some harmonics. Now for Ampere circuital law, the magnetic field strength is integral of HTL is the total current enclosed. So we are neglecting the iron portion. So mainly this is the fly path. So G is the gap length. So twice G. So twice G into H is equal to NI, where I is the current and N is the number of turns. So GH is NI by 2. So this height is NI by 2. Now, if we go for the Fourier analysis, the fundamental of this, that rectangular wave, that can be shown to be 4 by pi NI by 2 AT per pole. Now this I, in case of AC machine, this is alternating in nature. So I is variable with time. So I, if we put the maximum value of this MMF will be, say, if this is F1P, so F1P maximum is 4 by pi into N, the maximum value of I root 2 I by 2, AT per pole for 2-pole machine. And for 4-pole machine, it will be 4 by pi N root 2 I by P for AT per pole. Now, why coming P? Because here we have shown two air gaps because it is crossing the air gap twice, because we have a 2-pole machine. If we have 4-pole machine, the distribution will be look like this. So it will cross the air gap 4 times. So for P-pole machine, it will cross the air gap P times. So in general, this is the maximum value of the MMF for P-pole machine. So instead of a concentric winding, if we have a, so for concentric winding, the distribution is mainly rectangular in nature. If we have a distributed winding, that is the same in turn, instead of concentrating in one slot, if we distribute in, say here I have distributed in these three slots. So the slot angle is very small. We can consider to be the current density to be almost uniformly distributed. So for this coil, it can be considered that summation of three coils, that this one coil, this one coil, and these two makes another coil. So we have this and this. Considering this, this will be three MMFs considered. This, for this coil, this is the MMF distribution. For this coil, this is the MMF distribution. For the third one, this is the MMF distribution. And all have the, if the number of turn N in each slot, then it is half N by I, half NI. So if we add three, then this is the resultant. So resultant will be this maximum value 3 by 2 NI. Now this is basically a stepped wave. But actually, this angle is very small compared, this is 180 degrees. These angles are very small compared to this. So approximately, we can consider it to be a almost uniformly distributed. So it is a straight line. So approximate, it can be approximated to a trapezoidal wave. So this trapezoidal wave, if we go for the Fourier analysis, this trapezoidal wave for this portion, this is changing from minus 3 by 2 ni to plus 3 by 2 ni within this phase span of sigma. So this is 0 to sigma by 2 ni by sigma theta sine theta d theta plus sigma by 2 to pi by 2 up to that it is repeated. So ni by 2 sine theta d theta. If we analyze, you will see this expression is like this. So this is 4 by pi ni by 2 into this expression. This, if you remember, this is the expression of the distribution factor for the distribution factor. So this is basically the EMF which is induced for the single winding is multiplied by the distribution factor KD for distributed winding. Similarly, if we have a distributed short pitch winding, again a factor will come which is the pitch factor. So basically it is multiplied by the winding factor. So in the single phase concentric winding it was 4 by pi 1 by P ni, so that is multiplied by KD into KP, that is the distributed winding factor. Now this I, you can see that this I is changing with time. So this I is, say, I max sine of omega t. So FP1 is proportional to number of turns into Im sine of omega t. So for different time, that is say at time t is equal to 1, FP1 is equal to Fm sine of omega t1. At t is equal to t2, it is Fm sine of omega t2. At t is equal to t3, it is Fm sine of omega t3. Now, so F1 at any particular point on the rotor surface at an angle alpha. So F1 is FP1 cos alpha at omega t is equal to omega t1. So Fm sine omega t1 cos alpha at the same point for at omega t2. It is at time t2, it will be Fm sine omega t2 cos alpha. At time t3, it will be sine of omega t3 cos alpha, and so on. So in general, it is a function of alpha and t. So this is Fm is Fm sine of omega t cos alpha. So if we plot, that is, this is F as it is varying with time. So at F1, at time t1, t is equal to t1, the maximum will be proportional to this current. So maximum will be this F1. Then at t is equal to t2, maximum will be this. T is equal to t3, maximum will be this. But the form is the same, that is the same sine wave, so but the maximum value is changing. So the point at which the maximum occurs and where the field is zero, these two points are fixed, but what is changing is the magnitude. So a distributed a single phase winding, what it creates a pulsating field, that is a field which is stationary in space but whose magnitude are changing with time. Okay, I think today we'll stop here. Next day we will go for the rotating magnetic field. Okay, after this portion is over, this write-up I will forward to you. Can we have a class on the Thursday again? Hello. থার্সডে আবার থার্সডে তিনটের সময় ক্লাস করবো,
ইয়েস ম্যাম ইয়েস ম্যাম,
গো ফর দ্য রোটেটিং ম্যাগনেটিক ফিল্ড অন নেক্সট ডে,
ওকে ম্যাম।
ম্যাম will you share this PDF with us?
একটা করে চ্যাপ্টার শেষ হয়ে গেলে আমি রাইটআপটা শেয়ার করে দেবো, ঠিক আছে?
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে
ঠিক আছে।